Biographies of the 63 great men, the Shalaka Purushas, are referred to already in the canonical scripts of the Shvetambaras. In course of time, these biographies become more and more extensive, adding various former existences of the heroes, be it as a god, a human being, an animal, or even a denizen of hell. Quite interesting cases are lives of Shalaka Purushas, which intersect with existences of future Shalaka Purushas. One well-known example is Marichi. He's the son of Bharata, the first Chakravartin, and the grandson of Rishabha, the first Tirthankara of our current world age. According to a prophecy, he was to become Vardhamana Mahavira, the last Tirthankara of our era. Furthermore, it was predicted that he would become a Chakravartin in the Videhas, and Marichi would become Tivitu, in Sanskrit Triprishta, the first Vasudeva of Bharata. The life of Tivitu is another example of the intersection of one Shalaka Purusha with a future great man. Tivitu's son-in-law, Amiyateya, is a former existence of Santi, or Sanskrit Shanti, the 16th Tirthankara and simultaneously the 5th Chakravartin. How do the texts about Jain universal history deal with such an intersection? The first Vasudeva Tivitu is a contemporary of Sijamsa, or Sanskrit Shriyamsa, the 11th Tirthankara. But part of his life overlaps with the former existences of Santi, the 16th Tirthankara. Is his biography for this reason told twice in the texts? Are his heroic deeds, as the killing of a murderous lion with his bare hands, the slaying of his enemy Asagiva, and the conquest of the southern half of Bharata, narrated elaborately in his biography and then referred to again in the context of Chinasanti's former birth? This is definitely not the case. Tivitu's detailed biography is either embedded in the narrative of Shriyamsa's life, as it is the case in Himachandra's Trishasti Shalaka Purusha Charita, or told immediately afterwards, as in Sri Lanka's Chaupanna Mahapurisacharya, Gunabhadra's Uttara Purana, or Pushpadanta's Mahapurana. So for the sources, please look at my handout. In all these works, after some chapters, Tivitu is appearing again. In the narrative of Chinasanti's former lives, he's referred to as the husband of the beautiful Sayampabha, as father of two sons, Sirivijaya and Vijayabhadda, and of a fair daughter, Jyotibhabha. Tivitu's brother-in-law, Akakiti, begot one son, Amiyateya, and a daughter, Sutara. Sutara married Tivitu's son, Sirivijaya, and Amiyateya married Tivitu's daughter, Jyotibhabha. And from this point on, Tivitu is not appearing again. As his heroic deeds have nothing to do with the story of Amiyateya, the future Chinasanti, they are not even mentioned in this context. That is, they are not mentioned in the works I referred to above, but there is one text that presents the story of Tivitu in a totally different way. And here the story of our first Vasudeva is really told twice. It is in the Vasudeva Hindi of Sangadasa, probably composed in the 5th century in Jaina Maharashtri. Contrary to the texts mentioned above, the Vasudeva Hindi is not a work dealing with the whole of Jain universal history. Its main narrative centers around the adventures of Vasudeva, the father of Vasudeva Kanha, or Sanskrit Krishna, and is mostly borrowed from Gunadhyas Brihatkatha. This main narrative is wrapped in several layers of pure Jain origin and interspersed with many secondary stories, often narratives about Shalaka Purushas. Here the biography of Tivitu is quite striking, as it is the only narrative that is told twice. At a first glance, this fact indicates an interpolation. And there are some parts in the Vasudevahindi that are conspicuous to be later additions. But at a second glance, both stories make sense, not only in their narrative surrounding, but also in the way how they are told. The first version of Tivitto's biography occurs in Vasudevahindi, page 275, line 9, till 278, line 30. The story is told for the following reason. Vasudeva, the hero of the Vasudevahindi, reaches in the course of his wanderings the city Savatthi. There he notices in a temple the statue of a three-footed buffalo. He asks a Brahmin for the reason why this buffalo has only three legs. The Brahman tells Vasudeva the following story. Long time ago, there lived in Savatthi a harmless buffalo named Badaga. The king had granted him freedom from fear, and Badaga was roaming about the city the whole day without harming anyone. Once Prince Migadhaya noticed the harmless animal, drew out furiously his sword, and cut his foot with one stroke. The king was angry for the disrespect towards his decree and ordered to execute Prince Migadhaya. Instructed by the king's minister about the karmic results of committing violence, the prince decided to renounce the world. In course of time, he attained Kevalagnana, perfect knowledge. He remembered the previous lives of him and the buffalo, leading to their enmity in the present life. He, the former Prince Migadhaya, had been Asagiva, overlord of all Vidyadharas. His minister Harimamsu was a Nastika and tried continuously to convince Asagiva of his materialistic worldview. At the same time, there lived in Poyana King Dakka, who had a son, Ayala, and a daughter, Miyavati. Enamored in his beautiful daughter, he took her as a wife, earning thus the nickname of Payavayi, or Sanskrit Prajapati, master over his offspring. To bend her to his will, he used not only sweet words and gifts, but he referred also to the materialistic teachings of Harimamsu, Asagiva's minister. Finally, she obliged. He begot with her a son, Tivitu, who grew up together with his elder half-brother, Ayala. There lived another Vidyadhara king, Jalanajadi of Rahaneora Chakkavala, whose gorgeous daughter Sayampaba had come of age. He had pondered to give this beauty to Asagiva, the overlord of the Vidyadharas, but his fortune-teller Sambinnasoya had advised him against this marriage, as Sayampaba would become the wife of Paraha's first Vasudeva Tivitu. At the same time, Asagiva consulted his own fortune teller as well, putting him the question if he had an enemy, which his fortune teller answered in the affirmative. And how should he recognize him? He will mistreat the envoy Chandasiha and kill unarmed a lion. Immediately, Asagiva sent his envoy Chandasiha to all royal courts. In brief, Chandasiha was abused by Tivitu and Ayala, whereupon Asagiva asked them to go and kill a ferocious lion who pestered the people in the western part of the country. As the lion was unarmed, Tivitu considered it as a matter of honor to attack him without weapons. He teared the lion apart and sent the terrified Asagiva the two pieces. Asagiva asked for Sayampaba's hand, but her father, King Jalanajadi, married her off quickly to Tivitu. A war began, and after 6 months, Tivitu managed to kill Asagiva with his chakra and became thus the first Vasudeva. Asagiva went to the seventh hell. His minister Harimamsu had joined him after his death. The former Asagiva was convinced that this Harimamsu has come to destroy him and a deep enmity involved. They tormented each other for 33 Sagaropamas, and as we know, that is a very long time. The monk Migadaya, the narrator of this story, pursued the further lives of Harimamsu. The former Nastika lived alternating between a birth in a hell and a birth as an animal, till he was born as the harmless buffalo Bhadaga. His former master Asagiva suffered similar rebirths, till he gained a birth as Prince Migadaya. Because of this former enmity, he became furious and harmed the innocent animal. Enlightened by his father's minister, he became a monk and attained omniscience. Bhadaga, also instructed by the minister, refused food and gained after his death a rebirth as a god. This is the story as it was told to Vasudeva by a Brahmin. As we can see, the focus lies on the first Prativasudeva Asagiva. It is his life that is traced and not that of the first Vasudeva. The biography of Tivitu ends with Asagiva's death. Neither his further deeds nor his offspring are mentioned. While Tivitu vanishes into oblivion, Asagiva's story continues even after his death, till his last rebirth as Prince Migadhaya. The second version of Tivitu's biography in Vasudeva Hindi, page 310, line 5, till 323, line 24, is told by two monks who have just returned from the mountain Sameya, where they have worshipped the place of the Parinirvana of the Tirthankaras. As they mention the Kodisila, which is connected with Chinasanti's Ganadhara Chakauha, Vasudeva begs them to narrate the story of Chinasanti and his Ganadhara. The monks agree. This time the narration does not start with Asagiva, which does not surprise us very much. But neither it starts with Tivitu. It is King Jalanajadi, his son Akakiti, and especially his daughter Sayampabha, who are mentioned first of all. As the time passed, Sayampabha grew up to become as beautiful as a goddess. Contrary to our first version, where Jalanajadi consulted only his fortune teller Sampinnasoya, in the second version, he summoned his ministers to discuss about an appropriate bridegroom. After a long discussion, Minister Suyasagara suggested a Svayamvara in view of Sayampabha's extraordinary beauty, so that nobody could bear a grudge against the successful candidate. King Jalanajadi accepted Suyasagara's suggestion, honored his ministers, and called his fortune teller Sampinnasoya, who predicted, as in the first version, that Sayampabha would become the wife of Paraha's first Vasudeva Tivitu. King Jalanajadi sent immediately a messenger to King Payavayi, also Prajapati, and the proposal was accepted. At the same time, Asagiva, consulting his fortune teller, came to know that he had an enemy. And as in the first version, he could identify Tivitu as his foe, as he mistreated the envoy Chandasiha and killed unarmed a lion. Asagiva asked for Sayampabha's hand, but her father, King Jalanajadi, married her off quickly to Tivitu. The following battles and the duel between Tivitu and Asagiva are described much more in detail as in the first version. Tivitu managed to kill Asagiva, who is not mentioned anymore, not even as an inhabitant of the seventh hell as in the first version. The story goes on with Tivitu's coronation, his lifting of Mount Kodisila, and his marriage to 16,000 maidens, with Sayampabha being his principal queen. She got two sons, Sirivijaya and Vijayabhadra, a daughter, Jyotibabha, and a daughter, Jyotibabha. So for this family connections, you can look at my handout. So. Tivitu's brother-in-law, Akakiti, begot one son, Amiyateya, and a daughter, Sutara. Some years later, Tivitu arranged a Svayamvara for his daughter, Jyotibabha, and for her cousin, Sutara. Sutara chose her uncle Tivitu's son, Sirivijaya, while Jyotibaba elected her uncle Akakiti's son Amiyateya, so a cross-cousin marriage. After enjoying pleasures till his end, Tivitu died and went to hell. His brother, the Baladeva Ayala, renounced the world. In the course of time, he attained Kevalanyana. The following narrative centers on the former and present lives of Amiyateya and Sirivijaya, culminating in Kevalin Ayala's prediction that Amiyateya will in his ninth birth become Bharaha's fifth Chakravartin and at the same time 16th Tirthankara Santi, and Sirivijaya will become his first Ganadhara. If we look now closer at both versions, we can see that they deviate in some minor variations. The most conspicuous differences, however, are closely connected with the narrative embedding and thus with the reason why these stories are told. The narrator of the first version, Monk Migadaya, wants to explain his enmity with the buffalo Bhadaga. His narrative focuses thus on his former self, Asagiva, first Prativasudeva of this world age, who had been devoted to the Dharma, but was won over to the materialistic worldview by his minister Harimamsu, the future buffalo Bhadaga. Not only Asagiva became infected with these materialistic ideas, they spread also to the royal courts of his subordinate kings. As Miyavayi pointed to Dakka, her father, that a relationship between father and daughter would be a great sin, Dakka refuted her assertion, referring to Harimamsu's teachings. So as we can see, Harimamsu and his materialistic teachings have a firmly established role in Monk Migadaya's narrative, a fact that is totally lacking in the second version. The focus on Asagiva and his minister becomes particularly obvious regarding the striking end of the story. After Tivitu's victory over his adversary in the battle, it is the loser we follow through various rebirths, not the great hero and first Vasudeva, Tivitu, who disappears completely from our view. It is obvious that the biography of the first Vasudeva of this world age can't be told in this way, or rather, not exclusively in this way. It has to be told again, and this time with an emphasis on the real hero, Tivitu. As expected, this time the story does not start with Asagiva, but surprisingly neither with Tivitu, but with his future father-in-law, Jalanajadi. Here we have to keep in mind that Jalanajadi's grandson, Amiyateya, is a former birth of Jinasanti. And it is for this reason, that is to relate the biography of Jinasanti, the story is told. Jalanajadi's search for an appropriate bridegroom for his beautiful daughter, Swayamprabha, is much more elaborated, adding a discussion with the king's ministers and giving thus more weight to the future son-in-law, Tivitu. Interestingly enough, in this version, Tivitu's descent is disregarded. The story of Dakka, who took his daughter as a wife and begot with her a son, Tivitu, is completely lacking. It seems that the narrator of the story, of the second version, wanted to ignore silently the somehow derogatory roots of Amiyateya's father-in-law, a family-in-law. Instead, passages that show Tivitu's heroism are narrated much more in detail compared to the first version. For example, the fight between him and Asagiva occupy 11 lines, while in the first version it is dealt with in one mere sentence. The deeds and further spiritual development of Vasudeva Tivitu and Baladeva Ayala are traced even after Asagiva's death. The main emphasis lays now on Tivitu's son Sirivijaya, the future Ganadhara Chakauha, and on his son-in-law Amiyateya, the future Tirthankara Santi, who were not mentioned at all in the first version centering on Asagiva. As we have seen in the Vasudeva Hindi, the narrative of Tivitu had to be told again, And his connection with Amiyateya, a former birth of Chinasanti, was a good opportunity to retell his biography in the proper way. Or might it have been the other way around, that the author of the Vasudeva Hindi has created this connection to retell the story of Tivitu? I have found no evidence, and please correct me if I'm wrong, that Tivitu is connected with the former birth of Chinasanti in a text older than the Vasudeva Hindi. The later texts dealing with Jain universal history could have taken over this intersection from the Vasudeva Hindi tradition. Whatever the case may be, in the context of the Vasudeva Hindi and its narrative framings, it is for certain intelligible, if not necessary, to narrate the story of Tivitu twice. Thank you.